Hi, welcome to the seventh session of the History of World Revolutions. Today we're going to be talking about the Russian Revolution, a revolution which arguably is the most important of the 20th century, in part because of the sheer size of Russia itself. It is an enormous land, as we'll see in a moment. It was, at the time of the revolution, a country of more than 125 million people. It was located on the borders of a series of other strategic important nations in the world, including such places as China. But more than its size, its population, its geography, the significance of the Russian Revolution stems from its impact. Throughout the 20th century, we have seen, and into the 21st century, reverberations from the Russian Revolution. This is the first revolution to really call itself a Marxist revolution, and indeed to try to create what Marx envisioned, a communist society, a communist revolution. And the revolution would have wide-ranging impact on much of the rest of the world. Societies throughout Africa, the Middle East, and Asia, and parts of Latin America would try to imitate, in many ways, aspects of the Russian Revolution. If not all of its ideology, certainly many of its efforts at development and at creating more egalitarian societies. So it is a revolution which, on the one hand, has had enormous impact because of the imitative aspect of the revolution. So many other countries and societies have looked to it as an example, and we'll see why today. But also because, of course, it was the main contender in a struggle for world influence throughout the 20th century with this society, the United States, and other parts of the Western world. The struggle over whether the world would become a series of socialist, perhaps communist societies or capitalist societies was fought throughout much of the 20th century after the Russian Revolution itself. So we can see the implications of the revolution, and just about every other revolution we're going to look at in the remainder of the course is one way or another influenced by the Russian Revolution, as we will see. Before we actually talk about the revolution itself, its historical background, first of all, in terms of Russia's history, we do need to look a little bit at geography just to understand, again, the sheer size of Russia. And if we look at this map, which is rather small, but I think they can, oh, great, they've really been able to focus in on this thing. When you look at this black border here, this is as far as Russia or the Soviet Union eventually expanded by 1970. But even in an earlier time in the period that we're talking about, if you look at these gray areas, you see this enormous territory stretching across what is the Eurasian continent. Over here is Europe. Down in this area, you'll find the Middle East. And over here is China. You see the enormous stretch of Russia itself. But most of what we're going to be talking about today occurs in the western portions of Russia, particularly here at Moscow, which becomes the national capital, but also what here on the map is called Leningrad, the city in the north towards Finland. But at the time, Leningrad was known as Petrograd or St. Petersburg, named after Peter the Great, as we will see, the founder of the city. This is where the Imperial Palace was located, and it is between Petrograd and Moscow that many of the most important events of the revolution will take place. And it is in Western Russia, really, where much of the historical developments that shaped the Russian Revolution evolve in the centuries over which we're going to be talking about. One other place worth noting is Kiev, the city of Kiev, which eventually becomes part of Russia and part of the Soviet Union. We'll see its historical significance in a moment because it was one of the first important centers of political power in this part of the world back in the 9th century. And its eventual disposition has a lot to say about what happens to Russia, what Russia was like down in the centuries leading up to the revolution. And finally, looking just briefly here at what we refer to as Eastern Europe, places like Poland, this again is worth noting because this was another center of power in the early centuries during the evolution of Russia itself, and we will see the significance of that in a moment, how power eventually evolves and devolves onto this center in Moscow, and how Moscow eventually builds itself from really a city-state into this enormous empire that stretches across Eurasia. Now, back in the 9th century, the center of power in that part of the world that we just looked at was that city of Kiev, the Duchy of Kiev. and to describe the Duchy of Kiev as a small principality, kingdom, if you will, although the term duke was applied to the ruler. Kiev looks somewhat like the Western societies that we've already examined, like France and England, in the sense that it had a series of elite groups. In fact, we might find the comparison to France particularly striking. We have a series of elite groups dominated by a monarchy, in this case a duke, and those other elite groups were ones that are very familiar to us after examining France in the 18th century. They would include a landowning elite, which would be the boyars, peasants, and the influence of Christianity, Orthodox Christianity in this case. Christianity had really split between Western Christians, Catholics, and then Protestants, but in an earlier time there had been a spin-off in the Eastern Mediterranean of a separate Christian Orthodox Church, and it is Orthodox Christianity that dominates Kiev and indeed Russia down through the centuries and down to today. Again, a Christian tradition, but one which split off from the control of Rome long before the Protestant Reformation. This is a composition with a hierarchical system which we're quite familiar with by now. It looks very much like the other, at least two of the other societies we looked at, France and England. And of course, with a Christian religion providing the justification for rule by the duke and a hierarchical system. It is also similar in the sense that in the Duchy of Kiev, the elite had a reasonable amount of influence in the governing of the state. You know, we've seen this, for example, in France, that the king was always contending with the elite in terms of control and power, had to take some recognition of their interests and concerns. And this is what I refer to as this liberal tradition. I don't mean that this was a democratic, elected government or society by any stretch of the imagination, but liberal in the sense that there were a group of elites who had some influence upon the system. It is not a total autocracy. In other words, one person at the top giving all the orders, everyone simply obeys and does what they're told. There is some balancing of power, as we saw in France, between the king and the Parlements, with the Parlements representing the nobility. Here in the Duchy of Kiev, there was a similar type of tradition with a certain amount of balance between the duke and the boyars or the members of the nobility. However, this structure, this set of relationships, was swept away by the Mongols when they invade in the 13th century. The Mongols sweeping across the Eurasian continent from areas north of China all the way into these areas of what became Western Russia and wiping away the Duchy of Kiev and other duchies such as the one that existed in Moscow at this time. This whole area is subordinated to Mongol rule in the 13th century. Eventually, the Duchy of Moscow begins to emerge again as a centralized political entity by the 14th century. Here I speak specifically of 1328, when it became a tribute state of the Mongol Empire. So it develops a certain distinction from the rest of the empire, takes on some degree of self-control, self-rule during this period. It is Moscow that emerges as the most significant political entity in this western part of the Mongol Empire during the 1300s. By 1480, Duke Ivan III, the Grand Duke of Moscow, had asserted essentially the independence of Moscow from what was the crumbling ruins of the Mongol Empire. The Mongols swept across vast territories, set up a huge empire, but it was not destined to survive for a great deal of time. And Ivan was able to assert his independence and control by 1480. And Ivan also asserted the idea that Moscow represented the Third Rome. What did he mean by that? There were two other centers, recognized centers of Christianity. One was Rome in what we now know as Italy, and the other in Constantinople, in what we would now refer to as Turkey. Constantinople was the center of the Orthodox Christian Church, which had converted, Christianized people in Russia. What Ivan is claiming is that Moscow is this third center of religious control, that there is now a third key urban center for the Christian tradition, and it is Moscow. And that Moscow, therefore, is to be the dominant force and influence in the vast plains and regions that surround his city and his duchy. An assertion of centralized power that becomes the basis over time for autocratic control of this great empire that will be created in the centuries after Ivan's rule. So we see, even as of 1480, that what the rulers of Moscow are asserting is that their authority goes beyond simply being the dukes of a small duchy, a small political entity surrounding the city. Their vision is far greater than that. They believe themselves to be at the heart of the Third Rome, the new center of power for the territories surrounding them. That assertion of power grows even greater by the 16th century. By the 1500s, Moscow had begun to challenge the influence of other political states that had emerged, particularly to the west, in Poland and Lithuania, and indeed in warfare managed to defeat these powers. And it is now that the dukes of Moscow begin assuming a new title, that of Tsar, our emperor. It is now in the 16th century that we see the founding of the Russian Empire, where the rulers of this city-state, Moscow, which had really only emerged into significance in the 1300s, now by the 1500s, they are asserting that they are not only the Third Rome, but they are indeed themselves the rulers of an imperial state. And indeed, this becomes a central function of the Russian state for the centuries that follow. And that is, what is the Russian state? What is its function and its purpose? And its function and its purpose is to expand and control ever larger territories and to assure peace and stability in those regions. This becomes the central function of the state. If we go back to the map for just a second, when we were talking about expansion, and you look at Russia on this map, and you see here in this dark area, this was Russia back at this time in the 1500s, relatively reduced area. And then by 1598, the lighter shading. And then by 1689, encompassing this vast area that's Siberia. And on, the expansion will continue. So what is the Russian state? The Russian state is this expansionist power which provides peace and stability for the populations that it subdues over the centuries, particularly beginning in the 1500s. It's important to remember this because this becomes really the raison d'etre, the reason for being for the Russian state. Why does it exist? What is its main purpose? To expand and to provide stability. If it should be frustrated in those efforts, if it should suffer an enormous setback in terms of its ability to expand and protect, then the state itself could well crumble, and we're going to see that, in fact, will happen later on. The other distinctive feature that is developing in Russia at this time as it expands is the degree to which control is being asserted from the top down. Now, as with the earlier example with the Duchy of Kiev, we can identify in Russia in the 1500s a series of groups that are familiar to us from other early modern societies. A Duma, or an Estates General, as we would call it in France, exists. And we have a variety of different groups that belong to that, the boyars or the landowners, the nobility, the bureaucrats, government bureaucrats, army officers, and officials of the church. These types of groupings would look pretty familiar to people in France before the revolution, let us say in the 18th century, or in England in the 1600s or the 1700s. The distinction here, what is different about Russia from these earlier cases we have looked at, is the degree to which the Tsar will have control over these people, and the very, very limited degree to which the nobility and other groups will have a voice in the administration and management of the empire. Despite the existence of this body of elite groups, the truth is they have very little influence. This is the ultimate in autocracy, the ultimate example when indeed the czar, the emperor, rules all and makes the decisions. And no one can seriously question that authority without risk of life and limb. There is not a set of institutions. There is no such thing as the French parlements, where the nobility can essentially assert their interests and their rights, the idea of some rule of law. That simply doesn't exist here. The Tsar is in the process of becoming all-powerful, a true autocracy, far more power from the top than we have seen in any of the other examples of revolutions that we have looked at. And this becomes another important aspect of Russia's historical tradition in helping us to understand what happens in the Russian Revolution. There are no institutions that lend themselves to representative government in the centuries leading down to the revolution, because the Tsar is all-powerful. So the state has a function of expanding and maintaining stability, this military function, if you will, and it has a ruler who has a level of power and control that is really unmatched by other major states around the world at this time. Now, there are commoners, obviously, they're 90% or more of the population, and they are broken up into different tax-paying groups. Those who pay the taxes are the vast majority of the population, the commoners. When we look at the urban areas, see groups like merchants and servants, artisans would be included there. And in the countryside, serfs are peasants. And we'll talk about serfs in just a second. So we have, on the one hand, a society when we break it out into these different groups of landowners and officials of the church and the bureaucracy, and then merchants and other urban dwellers and peasants in the countryside, all looks very familiar with other societies that we have examined. But here, the level of control at the top far exceeds anything that we have witnessed up until this time. And as far as the peasants, their position at a time when peasants elsewhere in the 1600s, the 1700s, are going to be asserting some degree of independence, are actually losing their independence. So in Russia, at a time when, you know, this is 100 years, 130 years before the French Revolution, before the French peasants are asserting their independence, Russian peasants are going in the opposite direction. They are losing power. And specifically in 1649, with the declaration of the legal status of serfdom, what that meant was that under this legal code, peasants who fell under this decree were now essentially property of the estates on which they worked. This was tantamount to slavery. The only difference between serfdom and slavery in real terms is that slaves can be sold off from the property on which they work. They are seen as separate from the property itself. They are the personal possession of whoever the slave owner is. But with serfs, they actually belong to the property. It's like they were fences, you know, on the property or a river running across it. They're part and parcel of the property. So they can be sold, but they would have to be sold with the property. But other than that, they are in effect slaves. Now, not all peasants in Russia are serfs. About half of the peasant population over time falls under this category. But it means that about half of the rural population, which is very substantial, is in a state of virtual slavery down through the centuries in Russia. This is how Russia's agricultural system will function, is with the imposition of serfdom. And of course, once again, this in many ways is another assertion of power by the Tsar, because who is going to enforce the system of serfdom? Who is going to make sure that it works? Well, ultimately, it is the Tsar's responsibility to see that the system, which burdens so much of the rural population, is maintained intact. Now, the powers of the Russian state could be seen in other areas as well. Again, comparing it to, let us say, France, which is a good comparison because the French government, you know, even before the French Revolution, had tried to play a significant role in the economy. There were arms factories and other types of state factories that the French government created to influence and develop the economy. But in Russia, that state control is far beyond anything that the French monarchs could have imagined during this same time period. In Russia, the Tsarist government not only has factories, they own mines, they own vast estates. There are huge areas of Russia where Tsarist or government estates dominate the land. So the government itself has an enormous role in the economy itself, far in excess of any other example that you could find, at least in Europe at this time. So we have a government that controls workshops, grants licenses for the manufacture of goods, owns estates and mines. This is a government that has a major role to play in the entire economy. Now, down through its history, another reoccurring theme in Russia is the issue of Europeanization or Westernization. There are many in Russia among the elite who are opposed to Western influence, who believe that Western influence will be corrupting, that their traditional society, the dominance of the Russian Orthodox Church, needs to be preserved. And it would be unwise to introduce innovations from the West that would threaten that stability and that order. However, it is also true that down through the centuries, various Russian monarchs, or czars, are going to try to incorporate certain aspects of Western societies into Russia itself, to westernize Russia to some degree, to break away from what they see as some aspects of its backwardness. And that is their perspective, that the West represents progress, whereas much of what Russia has represents the past. So we have this ongoing process and effort going on as some czars step forward and try to adapt aspects of European societies into Russia itself, and face a certain degree of opposition from groups who resent this process of Westernization. The three principal examples would be Peter the Great, and here I've given you their dates, and Catherine the Great, Catherine II, and Alexander II. These are three czars who are particularly known for this effort to modernize or Europeanize Russia itself. Peter was particularly well known. He had traveled to Europe. He had brought back engineers and craftsmen to try to introduce some of the technologies and economic operations of European societies into his own economy. He gained that reputation as the great Europeanizer. His building of Petrograd or St. Petersburg, which he wanted to be the capital of Russia, was symptomatic of this idea of modernizing, Europeanizing Russia. However, it's important to understand at the same time that while these Russian czars did want to Europeanize and modernize, it was in a highly selective way. What they really wanted to do was to introduce the economic efficiencies which they saw in the West, the administrative efficiencies, bureaucratic systems, etc., the military technologies of the West. But they had no intention of adapting or adopting the Western ideas of liberal government. None of these people that are mentioned here, whether it's Alexander or Catherine or Peter, had any intention of turning their state into some type of constitutional monarchy. Absolutely not in terms of their approach to political administration. So this is a selective adaptation of Western ideas, technologies, and it's specifically meant to increase economic growth in Russia, but at the same time to strengthen the state. If anything, to make the absolutist state even more efficient than it was before. In many ways, a modern police state. And that's what is really evolving under the Tsarist regimes in Russia down through the centuries, is a modern police state, where you have one authoritarian figure, who has control and uses the apparatus of modern technologies, modern administrative systems, to enforce his or her control over this society. So this is not a liberalization of politics or social relationships in Russia that is going on during these periods of Europeanization. It is instead an attempt to create a more efficient government which can more efficiently rule Russia in an absolute manner. By the beginning of the 19th century, Alexander I, the Tsar of Russia, is seen as the most powerful monarch in the world. This is because, in part, Russia played a central role in the defeat of Napoleon. If you're familiar with European history, the rise of Napoleon Bonaparte after the French Revolution, his attempt to conquer much of Europe, which finally collapses after his invasion and eventual defeat in Russia. In addition to the powerful role that the Russian military eventually played in Napoleon's defeat was the fact that, compared to other monarchs in Europe, Alexander seemed to have enormous power. Again, no other monarch in Europe could claim the kind of absolute authority that Alexander I had in Russia. So this is why he is seen as the most powerful monarch, because he has this tremendous army, he has this huge country that he rules, and his power appears to be absolute beyond anything imagined by other European rulers of the time. But the fact is, this is in many ways a facade, because when you look behind that apparent power in terms of the size of the Russian army and the absolute control that Alexander could exercise, the truth is, Russia in many ways remained far behind its neighbors in terms of its economic development, in terms of its social development, and this would become painfully clear in the years ahead, particularly after the demise of Alexander I. One of the realities in Russia in the 19th century is the recognition that serfdom itself represents a backward and inefficient system, forcing people to stay on the land and work it at the demand of the great landowners was not an efficient system for agricultural development. It discouraged innovation and technology because you could squeeze as much labor as you possibly could out of the serfs. They had little choice. People have very little initiative when they are caught in this kind of system where their lives are controlled by the great landowners. What initiative do they have, or what initiative should they feel they should take if, in fact, they have no freedom? So this was a system which, well, it had generated economic growth, agricultural exports for Russia, etc., was at its heart backward and inefficient. Furthermore, the miserable conditions in which peasants lived in Russia precipitated a series of peasant rebellions down through the centuries. In fact, one of the most famous occurred in the 18th century, led by a man named Pugachev. Pugachev was a Cossack who tried to lead a major uprising, and for nearly a year he held the Russian army at bay in south-central Russia before he was finally defeated. His rebellion is just one of the more memorable, but just one of a series of such rebellions that racked the Russian countryside down through the centuries, including in the 19th century, reflecting the immiseration of the Russian peasants. A clear indication of the fact that Russia was not keeping up with its European neighbors was the Crimean War. Now, we don't have to get into the details of the Crimean War other than to say that it resulted from Russia's ongoing desire to expand its influence in the regions around it. And one of those areas involved what is now the modern nation of Turkey, what was then known as the Ottoman Empire. The Russians were involving themselves in the Balkan region of what was then the Ottoman Empire. And the British and the French decided to try to frustrate that effort to expand Russian influence. This led to the Crimean War, a war that essentially pitted France and England against Russia. Now, the war is fought really on the borders of the Russian Empire, and yet the Russians are defeated. the message that comes out of this is that Russia is hopelessly inadequate in terms of its own military power. If it can't even win a war, which is being fought virtually on its own border, and when its enemies are traveling more than 1,000 miles to fight this war. You have this enormous logistical advantage that you're essentially fighting on your home territory, and yet you're defeated by your enemies. Here was a clear indication that Russia indeed had fallen far behind its European neighbors in terms of military capabilities, and as was quite rightly concluded, that meant and reflected the fact that Russia had fallen behind in terms of its economic and technological developments as well. So Russia was clearly on a path of decline while its neighbors were advancing in terms of their economic and social growth and, of course, their military capabilities. These kinds of lessons to the Russian Tsars led to reforms in an effort to modernize this political, social, and economic system. One of them was the zemstvos, which were representative councils created around Russia. Now, these, again, are not classic democratic institutions. They essentially consist of the local nobility. Landowners in the region, they're not the leading members of the nobility. What we call the gentry would be a term that's more appropriate. They're well-to-do landowners, but not of the very top order. But they are going to elect representatives to these councils, and the councils will have a role in administering the local provinces. This is an attempt by the Tsarist government to take this enormous authoritarian bureaucracy that they had created to rule the empire and try to stimulate it, try to inject some life into it. They did not intend to create a democracy. That was not their intention at all. But they were hoping, by drawing in the local elites, to revive the administrative system to more efficiently address local problems. So it was not a step towards democracy, but it was a step towards trying to make the administrative system more efficient. Then in 1861 comes the emancipation of the serfs. And again, this is not done out of the kindness of the heart of the Tsar, Alexander II. He's not, flowing in kind thoughts about the serfs. This is a very practical decision. We are falling woefully behind our neighbors in terms of our economic system. And clearly one of the problems is this system of semi-slavery called serfdom. We need to free the peasants, to give them some land, give them some initiative, some desire to become more productive. And this is the purpose of the freeing of the serfs in 1861. But as we will see, even that decision was couched in very conservative concerns. The emancipation has an enormous impact because Russia is in the land of 100 million people at this point in the mid-19th century. And more than 90% of them are peasants living in the countryside, and more than half of them are serfs. So we're talking about 40, 45 million people at least who are affected by this reform. But the idea of freeing the serfs and giving them some land is carefully couched. The concerns of the Tsarist government are that when they institute this reform, they're going to set off a social process that could destabilize the empire. They're afraid that many of the serfs will simply throw down their tools and head for the cities. Now, we don't have to stay here anymore. We're out of here. We're headed for the urban areas. That there would be this mass urban migration into the urban areas that would destabilize the whole system. Remember, this is a vast agricultural empire. If millions of people start pouring out of the countryside and into the cities, God knows what will happen in terms of social stability. So while the reform is dramatic in its effect, it is also very conservative in how it is done. First of all, payments have to be made by the serfs for the land that they receive. The landowners, the members of the elite, have been paid by the Tsarist government for the land. Now the government is going to collect that money from the serfs. That money will be collected by the local peasant councils, the village councils, called mirs. these were the representative bodies. The closest thing you got to representative bodies in the Russian countryside were the mirs, or the peasant councils. These councils would now be responsible for collecting the redemption payments that were due the government. Why? Well, other than the fact that, yeah, the government wanted to collect a little bit of money, the real issue here was, all right, you now have some land, but you're not free to go anywhere because you owe money. You have to pay us for the land. It's like a mortgage that's been taken out. And this traditional peasant councils, the mirs, are going to collect that money. So you're going to be required to stay here until those repayments are made. Now, this was going to take 40 years. Eventually, the government canceled the redemption payments a few years before they were to end. But the whole idea was, don't let the peasants go running off and just abandoning the land. They have a legal responsibility. They have to stay there. And this will reinforce the power of the mir itself, this very traditional peasant council, and will keep the peasant community much as it was in the past. And indeed, the way land is distributed in peasant communities is strips of land. You don't just get one rectangular or, you know, square plot of land and that's yours and you work that piece of land. There may be a large piece of land and there are individual strips set aside, alternating strips. One family gets one piece, then another family, then another family, and eventually the first family gets another strip, so that the agricultural holdings of the village are really divided up into very small pieces, with each family holding a series of such strips. Now, there's a practical reason for this for peasants, and that is that when you look at the land in any location, some land is better than others. Some is more fertile than others. Some is closer to the river. Okay, some is on land that tends to be more moist most of the year, that's better for growing this or for grazing. So peasant communities in the past had deliberately divided land up this way, so there was a relatively equitable distribution. So one family didn't get the best land, and then one family got the worst land. So they divided up into these strips. It was not an efficient way to produce agricultural products if you want to produce a lot, but it meant there was a certain balance within the village that no one family would necessarily exceed the others. Now, that does not mean there was perfect, you know, communion and everybody was on an equal footing, but it helped retain some degree of balance. That system is retained as well. It's not very efficient. There's a lot more efficient ways to work the land, but again, it would help create some stability, preserve the community. So they want to free up the villagers. They want them to be more efficient, but at the same time, they're putting limitations on this because they're afraid the peasants will flee the countryside. So this is a reform, and it's important, but it still preserves, it's a halfway measure, preserves much of the old order. Now, despite the efforts to keep people on the land, the truth is that there is a significant migration into the cities. In the mid-19th century, this was, however, not, for the most part, a permanent migration. People who left and went to the urban areas usually went to work for a few months, find work, paying wages, to help supplement what they were making as peasants. So many of the people that migrate to the cities in the mid-19th century are going essentially to earn a living for a few months during the winter when there's little activity in the agricultural area, and then they'll return to their plots of land and begin sowing the seed and harvesting crops. But there is a significant number of peasants who are leaving and gaining some urban work experience. As we move further into the 19th century and come to the end of the 19th century, more and more of these people are going to be staying permanently in those urban areas. And their experiences of industrialization are in enormous factories. Many of these factories that are built at this time, and again, St. Petersburg or Petrograd and Moscow are the two key centers here of industrialization, just as they are the key centers for political developments. These are factories that employ perhaps 1,000, 2,000, sometimes 3,000 workers. These are enormous factories, and the workers live in huge barracks. So their exposure to industrialization comes in a very abrupt fashion. Now, they go from perhaps being serfs or, you know, poor peasants in the countryside to being exposed to a relatively advanced version of the first industrial revolution. You know, they're not starting out just weaving cloth at home, and then maybe one of them moves to a small factory, and as happened in England in the 17th century and the 18th century. Here there was this abrupt shift from moving from the countryside into these vast industrial plants in the great urban areas. That experience over time will help radicalize workers. They are in huge numbers. They are able to communicate with each other. They live, literally bunk by bunk in these huge barracks that are set up for them. They are being exposed to capitalism in many ways at its worst form, in terms of large industrial plants where management is largely indifferent to the fate of the workers. We will see that the working classes of Petrograd and Moscow will become acutely radicalized by this experience in the second half of the 19th and beginning of the 20th century. Now, there is also a middle class in Russia, although not as extensive as we would find in most Western societies. Much of what we would term the middle class can safely be called the intelligentsia. These were well-educated people who were often fulfilling roles in government bureaucracies. They might be school teachers, they might be lawyers, or simply bureaucratic administrators of one kind or another. People usually with a university education. It is the intelligentsia which really provides much of the critique of the Tsarist regime in the 19th century. Many people in this middle class, this bureaucratic middle class, are increasingly disenchanted with the Tsarist system. They see Russia's failure to grow at anywhere near the rate that its neighbors have grown. If they look at England or France and eventually Prussia or Germany as examples, these are countries that seem to be moving ahead at an incredibly rapid rate in terms of industrialization and modernization, and they do not see that happening in Russia, and they blame much of that failure upon the Tsarist regime itself. Out of those critiques, and there are a variety of people who are writing these criticisms at the time, emerge several political movements, including the populace. The populace, without getting into their ideology to any great extent, are emphasizing the idea of popular participation, the need for the common classes of Russia to have a role in Russia's development, that only when the people are listened to and have a voice, not necessarily outright democracy, but some type of participation, can a more efficient system be created. That the key problem is the very autocratic system that the Tsars have created over the centuries in creating this vast empire. One of the efforts of the populace was the Going to the People movement in 1873 and 1874. This project, if you will, reflected the ideas of these urban university-educated people, that what was needed to promote their ideas and their vision was more activism by especially the peasant classes of Russia, that they needed to bring them into this process. And the way to do that was to go into the countryside themselves, to live among the peasants and share their ideas so that they could help mobilize them to challenge the autocratic regime of the Tsars. The experiment was not very successful, in part because the Tsarist secret police and the Tsars regularly relied upon secret police and secret agents to deal with their political opponents, did not hesitate to arrest these people when they really seemed to be a threat. And even more importantly, in many ways, the peasants themselves were not necessarily highly receptive to these urban university-educated people who are coming in and talking about, this vast movement and how there's going to be change. Peasants have very practical, logical considerations. How are we going to get the grain planted this year? The seeds planted. How are we going to harvest our crops? Okay. Where am I going to get enough land to support my family? Great ideas about, the future of the empire and how the people can play a role in that. those very broad and abstract ideas don't necessarily ring very true to peasants. They have real concerns about those issues as well, but they see them from a very practical perspective, which the populace were not prepared to address. Now, how does this affect me directly? How are you going to help me in my concerns and my needs? In time, political repression and the failure of the Going to the People movement helped drive some of the intelligentsia to more extreme courses of action. Among those groups was a group called the People's Will. Their course of political action involved violence. They felt that with a significant number of political assassinations, they could hopefully destabilize their regime, if by no other means than by driving the Tsarist regime to even greater autocratic measures and prompting a popular revolution. But whatever the outcome might be, they believed that the tactic of political assassination was the means by which they could achieve eventual change of government. And in fact, they did assassinate a number of figures in the government, usually minor police figures. But then in 1881, they sort of hit the jackpot. They assassinated Tsar Alexander II. And they certainly brought on a massive wave of repression against all of the populist movements and, in general, the political opponents of the regime. But it did not spark a revolution at this stage. By this time, by the 1880s, the ideas of Karl Marx have penetrated Russia and are having a significant influence, particularly on people in the urban area and particularly among the intelligentsia, among educated middle-class people. Many of these ideas have an appeal because they really do speak to critical issues in Russia. The idea of the proletariat. Well, here is this proletariat. By the time of the revolution, there'll be at least 2 million workers, industrial workers in Russia, most of them concentrated in two cities, okay, in Moscow and in Petrograd. The talk of socialism, of creating a more equitable society. Well, where could one not want an equitable society in the case of Russia, where there is such inequity and such poverty, such extremes of wealth among the elite and the Tsarist regime versus the poverty of peasants and the suffering of workers? So here again is an appealing idea. How do we solve these problems? And also the idea of economic development, because of course within Marx's revolutionary thesis is the idea that the revolution will truly free up the technological capabilities of capitalism and create an even more prosperous society than it has existed before. So these ideas that Marx had talked about, even though what he was thinking about were more advanced industrialized societies, such as Germany and England at the time, these ideas have great appeal to the Russian intelligentsia because they seem to speak to many of their concerns. You know, how is economic development achieved? How do we create a more equitable society? And particularly the role of the proletariat in creating this revolutionary force, because of course they see right before their eyes in the matter of a few decades this working class emerging before them. So there are many aspects of Marx's writings that appeal to the intelligentsia given the conditions in Russia itself. And as we will see later on, in many other third world countries there's going to be a similar kind of experience that people in the middle class looking for some solutions to the acute problems in their society will see in Marx's writings ideas that are appealing to them in terms of trying to solve their own problems, even though Marx might have had a different type of society in mind when he was analyzing the potential for proletarian revolution. The major political movement that adheres to Marx's ideas is the Social Democratic Labor Party. However, in 1903, the party split between two groups, the Mensheviks and the Bolsheviks. Again, to get into the political intricacies of this split and exactly why it happens is beyond what we have time for, but the Mensheviks basically thought in terms of the creation of a social democratic system. In other words, a political system in which there would be elections, in which a national assembly of some type would be created, and socialist delegates would eventually constitute a majority and help bring on, you know, the rise of socialism and a socialist society in Russia. The Bolsheviks, on the other hand, had a very different view. They believed that to hope to promote that kind of process in Russia was a foolish dream. That given the conditions in Russia, the autocracy of the Tsarist government, its power and its willingness to suppress and repress its enemies, that the only way to achieve change would be by creating an elite group, a small cadre of revolutionary leaders who will go out and organize the working class and lead the revolution. That difference helped lead to the split between the Mensheviks and the Bolsheviks. And of course, it is the Bolsheviks who eventually come to be known as the Communist Party of Russia. And they are the ultimate successful revolutionaries. But this split had occurred already in 1903. And again, we can understand much of what the Bolsheviks felt given the conditions in Russia down through the centuries. They were certainly right about the fact that there was very little in the way of any kind of liberal tradition. There was very little reason to hope that, in fact, some type of representative system of government could be created anywhere in the foreseeable future to change the course of events in Russia. More specifically, it is Vladimir Lenin who emerges as the leader of the Bolshevik Party and talks about proletarian revolution. Of course, his call for proletarian revolution soon forces him to spend much of the following decade and more living in exile. He spends much of the years prior to the revolution itself. In fact, he only comes back on the eve of the final revolutionary push in Russia because he has to live in exile because the Tsarist regime is not going to countenance people like Lenin running around or the other Bolsheviks calling for revolutionary upheaval. Now, exactly when that revolution might occur, no one was really sure. And in fact, in the years leading up to and after the split, there were many in Russia, Mensheviks, Bolsheviks, and people of all political ilks, who would find it hard to believe that revolution was in the foreseeable future. Somewhere down the line it was going to happen, but it didn't seem to be in the cards immediately. The Tsarist regime just seemed too strong to be overthrown any time in the foreseeable future or forced to change in any significant way. But there were forces unleashed in part by the Tsarist regime itself that were bringing that change to Russia far sooner than most people could have imagined. The Tsarist regime in the last part of the 19th and first part of the 20th century was hell-bent upon rapid industrialization and modernization. The lessons of the Crimean War and of the freeing of the serfs, which had led to only limited economic change, were well understood within the Kremlin, within the halls of power of the Tsarist government. And as a result, Russia had thrown itself into, or the Tsarist regime had thrown itself into, a massive effort to modernize their society. Looking at Russia in 1900, it was easy for them to see that per capita income, the total income of the country divided by the number of people in Russia, was only one quarter of what it was in Great Britain. So the vast gap that existed between one of the nation's leading industrial powers and Russia was there for all to see. And the Tsarist governments were intent upon changing that. And indeed, when you look at what happens in Russia in the last decade of the 19th and first decade of the 20th century, there is tremendous growth. The economy is growing at 15% a year in the 1890s. This is spectacular. It's hard to maintain that kind of growth even for a year or two, and it's rare that an economy grows that fast at all. In addition, there is increasing literacy within the population, as the Tsarist government is anxious to educate the population, at least to the extent to have an educated middle and working class that can carry out some of the basic functions that are needed in a modern economy. As was always the case in Russia, it is the state itself that is directing this process. You know, this isn't just, well, gee, an industrial revolution happened to occur in Russia at this time through a fortuitous set of circumstances. This is a situation where the state is trying to drive this process forward. Two of the key figures were two of the leading ministers in the Tsarist government in these years. First, Sergei Vita, from 1892 to 1903, and Peter Stolypin, and that is the way you spell it, it's not missing an A, from 1907 to 1913. Each of these men had essentially the role of the prime minister, if you will, within the Tsarist government, responsible for government policies. And they both pursued a set of policies designed to push economic growth as rapidly as possible. And to do that largely on the backs of the popular classes and particularly the peasants. You know, when a society decides that it's going to industrialize and modernize at a rapid pace, somebody has to pay the bill. The money has to come from somewhere. And as we will see, some of it, as we saw with Mexico last time, you can get from foreigners, but a lot of it has to come internally. And in this case, the people who are going to pay the biggest bill were the peasants. The Tsarist government instituted a system of forced grain sales, meaning peasants were not free to simply put their grain on the market and sell it for whatever price they wanted, you know, whatever the market would bear. Instead, the regime was going to buy it from them at a fixed price, in part to generate revenues by being able to sell this grain at higher prices than they had bought it from the peasants, and in part to ensure that they could supply grain to the cities where they hoped to build their industrial base. Protectionist tariffs designed to protect budding industries in Russia. How are the peasants going to pay for this? This is going to drive up the cost of things like fertilizer that they use to produce their agricultural products. It's going to cost them a lot more in the end for the goods that they need for their own peasant ventures as a result of these protectionist policies. And control of vodka and vodka sales. This is not a matter of, gee, we all need a drink and you won't let us have one. But vodka was an extremely important product that peasants could produce from the grain that they grew. They could make money out of this by producing vodka. But if the government takes it over and is controlling it in order to, again, generate revenues, creating a monopoly, if you will, again, the peasants are losers. So they find they're forced to sell their grain at fixed prices. They're not allowed to produce vodka for sale. The government's going to do that, so they lose another source of income. And protectionist policies that raise cost to them of running their farms. So in many ways, these policies are designed to impose upon the peasants the burden of helping to pay for the rapid industrialization of Russia. Not surprisingly, facing this burden, peasant rebellion erupts time and again in Russia. And we'll see in a couple of particular instances in a minute or two. But throughout this period is a period of great instability in the countryside, after 1900 especially, because of these increasing burdens upon the peasant population. Sure, Russia's going to modernize, but it's the peasants who are going to have to pay the bill. Another step that's taken by the Russian government to increase efficiency under Minister Stolypin is the consolidation of land among the peasants. This is the step that they were afraid to take when they freed the peasants and freed the serfs back in 1861. Now they're going ahead with it because Stolypin sees this as the only way in the end of really introducing efficient agricultural practice into Russia. You know, you need people who control a segment of land which they can use, let us say, a tractor. That's kind of long shot right now for most Russian peasants, but a piece of consolidated land which they will work on their own and which will allow them to use the most efficient means possible to produce crops instead of hopping from, you know, one place to another. And what's the sense of having a large plow and a large group of oxen if you've only got one, this one narrow strip of land? You might as well, you know, work it with, you know, a hand plow if it's only a narrow strip, and then you have to go work another narrow strip. Well, consolidate it and that will make the peasants more efficient. But that also introduces instability into the countryside. Now, if we're going to consolidate this, this is an attack on the mir, on the village councils, because they are the ones who have shared up this land in the past among the peasants. And inevitably, some peasants are going to benefit more than others. No matter how you try to do it, some people are going to wind up with better land than others. So while this is a step towards efficiency, it's also a step that destabilizes the peasant populations in the countryside. In the area of industrialization, there is also strong forces pushing towards instability. As with Porfirio Diaz in Mexico, so too the Russian Tsar has settled upon a policy with his ministers that pushes foreign investment as the critical means of achieving industrialization. As much as the government is going to play a role in this and continue to develop factories and mines, etc., nevertheless, for Russia to really move forward quickly, it needs the capital and technology of the West. And European countries, specifically Germany, France, England, are going to be invited in, private investors, to rapidly industrialize Russia. And as I point out here in the outline, 41% of the capital in corporations, essentially, that's what it means by joint stock capital, in Russia in the years prior to the revolution belong to Europeans. So foreigners are playing a major role in this process. And remember, this is a process which has dire consequences for this new proletariat that's been emerging in Russia. These are people that are being thrown into the harshest of working conditions. Long hours, 12, 14 hours a day, minimal amount of pay, living conditions that are poor, if not horrendous, maltreatments in the industrial workplace itself. And not only are they further radicalized by their suffering in these industrial plants, but for many of them, the lesson is it is the foreigners who are bringing this suffering. It is the foreigners who have created so many of these industrial plants where we are forced to work, we are being exploited by these foreigners. So as in Mexico, although not to the same degree, there is a merging of two ideas. One, opposition to this process of industrialization, to the process of capitalist development, but a linking of that with the idea that much of this is associated with foreigners, and therefore what we need is a nationalist assertion to protect us from this exploitation by foreigners. So we have growing radicalism among the workers. This was already happening, but now in addition to that comes a linking of the ideas of radical reform to salvage the workers, with the idea that that somehow must include some reaction against the impositions of foreigners who are seen as the principal exploiters. In the years after 1900, Russia is a massive empire of 126 million people, probably the greatest imperial system of that time in terms of a single unified state. It is being ruled over by Nicholas, Tsar Nicholas, and his bride Alexandra. A more unhappy pairing would be hard to imagine in terms of the ability to rule. These were two people who probably would have had trouble managing their own household, never mind an empire of 126 million people. They were not highly competent. They were not highly efficient. They had some rather bizarre ideas, as we will see. And they were simply totally out of touch with what was happening in their own society and simply unable to cope. And they staggered from one ill-conceived decision to another. And with all of the other factors that helped bring on the revolution, certainly Nicholas and Alexander contributed to that process through their own sheer incompetence. Now, as incompetent as Nicholas may have been, he did follow some of the traditional patterns of earlier czars, specifically when it comes to expansionism. At this time, it was believed that new opportunities lay in the Far East for Russia. Russia had long been expanding into Siberia. Here we can go back to the map for a second and just look at it again. We see how far that Russia had come and more recent acquisitions and an effort by now to move into these areas just north of China. This is where the Tsarist regime saw its opportunities. But in moving into these areas, it is also coming into conflict with Japan, which also has its eyes set upon this part of the Asian continent. Nicholas's decision to push ahead with expansion into the East helps bring on war with Japan in 1904. Nicholas's advisors had told him, well, there wasn't much to worry about if they did wind up initiating or triggering a conflict with the Japanese, because the Japanese were, you know, a second-rate Asian power. You know, how could they possibly stand up to the great might of the Russian Empire? The answer was fairly easily. The Russian Empire suffered colossal defeats, particularly a naval defeat on the part of the Japanese, which sent the Russian military forces into retreat. So here is this vast empire seemingly taking on this small, what they believe to be inferior Asian country, and suffering massive defeat as a result. That process helped trigger a revolutionary upheaval in Russia in 1905. The upheaval begins in January of 1905, on what was known as Bloody Sunday, when a group of a few thousand workers in St. Petersburg, or Petrograd, tried to approach the royal palace. They were being led by a local priest. These were not radical workers. They were not part of, you know, any kind of Marxist revolutionary movement. They were just desperate to get help from the Tsar because of the terrible suffering they were enduring with shortages of food and miserable working conditions and a bitterly cold winter. And the Tsarist troops surrounding the palace opened fire on them and killed them, killed many of them. It was symptomatic of the inability of Nicholas to respond effectively, to see this protest for what it was, which was simply a desperate cry for help by some of the workers in St. Petersburg, rather than a revolutionary challenge to his regime. What follows are a series of worker uprisings in major urban centers, as well as peasant rebellions, peasants rising up, seizing land from local landowners and members of the nobility. And for a time, it appears that the revolutionary upheaval might actually take hold and topple the regime. However, the nobility, which had been swaying in its loyalty to Nicholas, given past defeats and the general miserable conditions in the country, finally threw its lot in with the Tsarist regime, realizing that the greatest danger to them was from the peasant rebellions rather than from the Tsarist regime's incompetence. And that decision, along with the fact that really the workers' rebellions occurred early in the revolution, the peasants' rebellions occurred later, so they were really two split and uncoordinated movements, those factors helped defeat the revolution of 1905. However, Nicholas recognized how close he had come to losing everything, and he did institute a series of reforms that he called fundamental laws, particularly the creation of the Duma in 1906. This was to be a representative body, and here we're dealing with situations, as we saw in the French Revolution, that you're taking what was a body that traditionally represented the interests of the nobility, of the elite in particular, and trying to create some type of representative assembly out of it. Again, the right to vote in Russia was severely restricted at this time. The representation in the Duma consists largely of members of the nobility and better off members of the middle class, but it certainly was some step forward in terms of Russia. The problem was that Nicholas really didn't believe in this whole process. He was still a true autocrat in every sense. And what we have instead is an authoritarian constitutional monarchy. In other words, Nicholas pretty much going on his own way to do as he sees fit, even though he still has this assembly, which is trying to exercise some control and some influence and create the basis for a constitutional monarchy in the true sense of the term. The failure of these reforms, and particularly the failure of the Duma to really significantly influence change in the Tsarist government, helped trigger new unrest in Russia. In 1914, for example, there's a mass general strike by workers in Petrograd. And this is, again, extremely threatening to the regime. And this is one of the two principal cities of the country. And here, the workers are, you know, at the gates of power, essentially, demanding change. And there are similar types of strikes and demonstrations racking the country as of 1914. The event that helps finally unleash these forces that had clearly been simmering up for a number of years, you know, long-term tradition of peasant rebellions and now growing worker unrest, the revolution of 1905, the event that finally sort of opens the floodgates is Russia's decision to enter World War I. Now again, since this is, of course, in diplomatic history, we're not going to get into all the wheres and the why fors of that decision. What is clear is that it was a disastrous decision for the Tsarist regime. Easiest way to explain it, 5 million casualties in the war, okay, between 1914 and 1917. A disastrous effect. The Russian army was totally unprepared for this war in terms of transportation, in terms of weaponry, in terms of its ability to deal with the sick and the wounded. Far more people were dying of disease and untreated wounds than were dying from, you know, bullets themselves. All kinds of diseases and plagues spread through the military, and these are, for the most part, soldiers who are being drafted en masse into this process and being chewed up on the front by the German forces. So this fact, and the fact that the war and the ability to sustain the war imposes even harsher conditions upon the Russian people than they had endured before. Now there are bread shortages and food shortages in general in the major cities that are really pushing people to the point of starvation. This isn't just a high cost of living and poverty. This is actual starvation that's now occurring in the effort to sustain this war effort. And of course, the disasters that are following on the front. Contributing to the disaster, in particular, is Nicholas's decision that he is going to assume direct command of his forces. If he had problems running the empire, he has even greater difficulties running the military. I mean, he's really not trained as a military commander. He really doesn't know what he's doing. And he absents himself from St. Petersburg, heads off to the front, and proceeds to engage in a series of blunders which only worsen the military conditions at the front, and in the meantime leaves his wife in the clutches of a monk named Rasputin. The potential heir to the throne, Nicholas's son, suffered from a variety of diseases, was prone to bleeding as a result of these diseases, and it was not believed that he would live to adulthood. Nicholas and Alexandra, desperate to save his life, had turned to this, well, he has to be called a charlatan of a holy man, a monk Rasputin, to try to save him from the hemophilia that he suffered from. Hemophilia was, it's a bleeding disease where even a bruise in its worst condition can cause you to bleed to death. Rasputin and Alexandra now become the commanders of the Russian government, with Nicholas absent at the front. And as one member of the Duma said, is this stupidity or is it treason? Meaning, these people are so incompetent, is it just that they don't know what they're doing, or are they actually trying to destroy Russia? This is how bad conditions were with Nicholas absent. Finally, a group of noblemen, desperate, invited Rasputin to dinner. poisoned his food, and when that didn't have a sufficient effect, shot him repeatedly. And when he was still surviving those effects, they wrapped him up in ropes and weights and threw him into the river, where he finally drowned. They managed to eliminate Rasputin, but they had in no way solved the fundamental problems of the Tsarist regime. Its efforts at modernization had triggered unrest among both peasants and workers, as well as the intelligentsia, and now the regime had led the country into disaster on the war front, undermining the one key important function of all Russian regimes, to expand and protect the population. Now, the Tsarist regime had created the terms for its own destruction, and indeed, its own destruction was rapidly on its way, and within months, the Tsarist regime would disappear forever in Russia. We'll come back and see how that happens and what the revolutionary consequences are in just a few minutes.